transmit ourselves around statewide. We're looking at a lot of empty chairs at the other libraries. Oh, no, there's somebody.
We're actually recording this today so that they can show it later.
Oh, are they recording? Okay. I'll try to watch my language. Would you all please welcome Rachel Barton Pine?
Hello.
So, Rachel, what we normally do with these is I chat for a little while about, well, kind of anything. often related to the program.
Sure.
And then it's your turn, and you can kind of say almost anything you want about, we'd love to hear about your background, where you studied, why you chose the violin, any stories of your...
Sure, and I should tell you about the particular violin.
Absolutely. the instruments that you brought, and then anything that you want to say about the Vivaldi or... Kind of anything.
Okay.
It's really your time. We need to finish at 1.
Okay. And we should leave a few minutes for the weird fiddle.
Yeah, absolutely. and these folks will ask you some questions. And when you're done, I will continue. So you don't have to fill all the time. Fill as much time as you're comfortable. I'll ask you some questions.
Well, my
also.
2-year-old is enjoying the library.
Oh, good.
So you've got me for as long as you want me. Because
my daughter loved this
give
place,
her
too.
More time to go.
Great, 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 great. she's 13 now. Enjoy it while you can. at any rate, it's a little awkward for me to do the lecture. I just came from the eye doctor. And I have the same posterior vitreous detachment in my left eye now that I had in my right eye. And I had 2 surgeries in this eye. And hopefully, as of today, I don't need any surgery in my left eye, I'm happy to report. But I was dilated to have the exam today, so you are looking a little hazy right now. And by tonight's rehearsal, I will absolutely be able to read this, but right now it's a little fuzzy. So I will make my comments brief, and I'm so happy that we have such a knowledgeable soloist this week to enlighten you with all kinds of way cool stuff. She brought her viola. Is it da gamba or d'amore?
D'amore.
Even better, which is will be a whole fascinating history in Baroque performance practice and the history of the violin for you nice people today. This program kind of bookends the beginning of the symphony as an art form, and then really, you know, one of the later pinnacle works for the genre. And the fact that they're both concertos kind of, you know, brings the whole thing full circle. The original symphonies were just groups of musicians that were fairly ragtag in the sense that it wasn't necessarily defined. It had to be these exact instruments. These were the instruments that accompanied operas and ballets. Need another chair?
No, go ahead.
Okay. And very rarely were works written for the instrumental ensemble alone. It was an accompanimental thing. And this sort of, the overture, which was the word symphony, was used in the Baroque era and the sort of early stages of opera, which is in a sense where the symphony was slowly born. The word symphony and the word overture were used interchangeably. So the art form hadn't really developed. In the early stages of the symphony as a separate ensemble performing by itself, not accompanying an opera or a ballet or a choral work, there were works called concertos or concerto grossi. And they were instrumental works, not symphonies, but multi-movement instrumental works that featured a soloist or soloists. And this is the early stage of the symphonic art form. And eventually these things grow and become symphonies, the sonata form, first movement, you know, et cetera, et cetera. In the hands of C.P.E. Bach and Franz Joseph Haydn, and then of course Mozart into Beethoven into Brahms, et cetera. So, that's, in a sense, the early structure of the symphony. Concertos in the hands of composers like Vivaldi, he was apparently a wizard of a violinist himself, fantastic violinist. So he wrote, I mean, this piece really is, you know, it means many, several hundred years ago that he wrote it. Still an incredible showpiece for a soloist. And I have to tell you, Rachel, I hope it was good for you last night, sweetie. It was just so much fun last night rehearsing with Rachel. She brings such a knowledge of Baroque performance practice and Baroque violin playing, but also, and I don't mean to embarrass you, but I'll just say this anyways, you just are really able to communicate so well to the musicians in the orchestra the sound that you want and how to get it. And we just were all, I mean, you know, we've all known and played Vivaldi the Seasons, you know, I can't even count how many times I've conducted it. You know, it's not one of those things that's in any way unfamiliar. So it's like, okay, here we go again. But it was like a world premiere last night. And listen, Rachel is conducting the Vivaldi. I'm going to be up there kind of looking really busy. But, you know, and there are a few transitions where I'm actually doing something.
Well, actually, that's a really good point, because in Vivaldi's day, you didn't have a separate guy with a stick, and that was his only role. There weren't yet such large ensembles where you needed somebody like that just to keep everybody together. You did have, you know, in France, Louis with his dance band, and he kind of banged his big staff on the floor.
And then, you know, on
keeping
his foot.
And
then he died from that.
Of gangrene.
Right.
So conducting can be dangerous.
Exactly.
But in a way, he was more like the drummer in a rock band. He was keeping the beat, and I think it was less the motion, the physical motion he was doing, than the pounding of the beat that everybody was keying into. But in any case, you know, if it was a piece without a soloist, often it would be either the concertmaster or the keyboardist leading from the harpsichord. In a case where there was a soloist, the soloist would generally lead the orchestra. And in fact, very often with both modern and period instrument ensembles, I will lead the orchestra without conductor. But I have to say, it's a wonderful luxury to have a conductor. Might not have been the way they did it in Vivaldi's day, but heck, it means that much less that I have to worry about, and that much more likely that all of it will actually succeed.
More likely, exactly. And then eventually attaining the moral high ground, conductors were invented and implemented regularly. At any rate, we're getting a view, even with me there, of the early chapter in symphonic music. And so my point is the colors, the sounds that Rachel got really wonderfully out of our string orchestra last night, that's her doing, wonderfully so. So then we fast forward through all of this amazing history of symphonic music through Beethoven, through the end of the temporary end of tonality, with essentially Richard Strauss's operas, Salome, and you know, it almost reaches, the composers at least felt like they'd reached the end of their rope in tonal music. So we have then the sort of birth of this 12-tone technique with Arnold Schoenberg, Schoenberg, Berg, and Webern are the three big 12-tone Germanic composers. For me, Schoenberg is the least successful of the three as a composer. Webern is actually my favorite 12-tone composer. But nevertheless, this is a period of music history that to this day alienates audiences. You're all nodding. Yeah, right. And frankly, there are a lot of musicians aren't exactly wild about it either. So then we have this next chapter. It is sort of the rediscovery of, you know, I mean, alternative plans. Where's classical music going to go? And Bartok in Romania is to Copland in America. Copland's discovering American folk music and jazz and things like that, and as early as the 1920s, implementing those things and creating the so-called American school. So Bartok, in his, you know, it was a genuine interest. He and Kodály, I guess, were very, very good friends. And they went about Romania, and you know, parts of the Czech Republic and other areas, notating the folk music of the time, writing it down for the first time ever, and then incorporating these folk rhythms and melodies in their compositions, and creating a new kind of sound. It wasn't the sort of, I mean, Beethoven incorporated folk music in his compositions as well, so really what they were doing was continuing the tradition, which I've spoken about many times. But the 12-tone guys are not in that realm. They're not writing anything that's necessarily all that hummable. They're not concerned. Schoenberg was, you know, his 12-tone pieces did not incorporate folk music, blah, blah, blah. So these things are all meshing together. So take Bartok. Were you going to say something?
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree with you about Schoenberg.
About Schoenberg?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. The least gifted, in my opinion, of the three. At any rate, I happen to genuinely love Fabert's music. He's the only 12-tone guy whose music I actually love. But don't, you're getting concerned. You're looking at me funny. We've only done one Schoenberg piece, or Webern piece, the whole time I've been here was at one of those old, remember we used to do those poetry slams my first couple of years? We played a piece of Webern, I forget what the poem was, but I went on this rampage of the rehearsal about what genius the piece was, and the musicians looked up at me like, sure, pal. At any rate, So take us to 1944. Bartok had moved to the United States, survived World War I and, you know, kind of got out, you know, during World War II. And he was not at all accepted as a composer in his day. He was, however, very much accepted as a concert pianist. He was pretty fairly successful at that. However, as he got older, touring, playing, you know, he really wasn't able to do that. He was struggling financially, and he was in the hospital, and everyone thought this was it. Well, in walks Serge Koussevitzky, visionary music director of the Boston Symphony, not known historically for being one of the great actual conductors of his time, but he was a visionary. So much of what became a part of the life of a modern American symphony happened at the Boston Symphony during Koussevitzky's time. Like, for instance, the Boston Pops was formed during his tenure. He's the guy who hired Arthur Fiedler to do that. Tanglewood, summer home of the Boston Symphony, started during Koussevitzky's time. The idea that the symphony would go to some beautiful outdoor location, play concerts, and start a school and teach young music, that all happened during Koussevitzky's watch. He discovered Leonard Bernstein. At any rate, he marches into Bartok's hospital room with a check for $1,000, which strangely perks Bartok right up. and he literally kind of, you know, suddenly feels better and writes the concerto for orchestra, literally on his deathbed. And he was alive for the premiere in 1945 in Boston. It's sort of the one and only piece he wrote that really went over big time with the audience when he wrote it. He was not alive, much like he died in 45, to fully enjoy the success of the piece. It's his only, I mean, Miraculous Mandarin is standard rep. Of course, the Viola Concerto is standard rep.
Violin Concerto number 2.
Yeah.
Some chamber music, the contrasts with clarinet that he wrote for Benny Goodman.
This piece really is by far the most programmed piece that Bartok ever wrote. So he did not live to fully, you know, enjoy the success of the piece. Nevertheless, he heard it, and that was great. So going back then to the original, you know, early chapters of the symphony, we've got Concerti and Concerti Grossi featuring certain solo instruments with orchestral accompaniment. Well, now the orchestra is the soloist. It's a concerto for orchestra. And this was fairly new. Ludwig, there aren't so many of these. Jennifer Higdon wrote a concerto for orchestra.
Ludislavsky
is the other one. That's it. There might be others written, but they haven't, you know, they haven't reached my desk. and I've only heard the Ludislavsky once, and I'm doing the Higdon later this year in Hudson Valley, which I'm really excited about. So it's not like this idea has like caught fire and now every, you know, symphonic composer is writing one. But the musicians have been asking for this for, I can't even remember how long. please, can we do Bartok Concerto for Orchestra? Because it's a challenge for them, and, you know, let's face it, it shines a spotlight right on them. And in any given, at some point in the entire piece, there's a pretty bright light shining on every section of the orchestra.
Is that what makes it different than if he had written the same music but called it a symphony? Like, what makes it a concerto?
I guess that, exactly. To me, it seems like a symphony is more thematically driven. And I think as he was writing this piece, obviously all good music is thematically driven on some level. But he was thinking, how can I really showcase and virtuosically? Like, for instance, particularly the second movement, there's five groups of material. It's five pairings of instruments, two oboes, and then two clarinets, two trumpets, two and then three bassoons. You know, it's very much a concerted effort to showcase those sounds.
So instead of having a soloist, like literally everybody gets a turn to solo.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty awesome.
It is awesome. Not individually. I mean, first violin section solos, but the winds and brass do. So, you know, second trumpet, third trumpet. They all have their moment. It is an incredible piece of music. Let's go back to the tonality thing. Bartok did, to some extent, embrace 12-tone, though never completely. Now, what is 12-tone? I mean, the history of harmony, I mean, if you actually study the overtone series and if anything, and look at the physics of sound, the overtone series first spells out a major chord, but then what we call a dominant seventh chord. If you continue tracing the notes up, a dominant seventh chord is a chord in traditional harmony that needs resolution. So it's almost like the physics of sound have presented us with the tonal system that we mostly use and embrace. Pop music is built on this tonal system, you know, from Rameau's treatise in 1722 and the well-tempered clavier? Yeah, 1722. All the way up through, you know, Kenny Rogers and Lucille. Go ahead, let that just sink in for a second. It's a certain system of harmonies that are resolution and harmonies that need resolution. It's a melodic system as well. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti wants to resolve to do. Same in harmonies. And it's essentially that friction, that tension between things that need to be resolved and things that are the sounds of resolution, that drives the drama of music, okay? So for a long, 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 long time, that's been what happened. So we get right up to the 20th century, Stravinsky's writing Rite of Spring, and Schoenberg in early 20th century, Berg, Webern, and then other composers are like, you know, this system no longer works. The system of tonality is outdated, it's archaic. And Schoenberg essentially comes up with this new mathematical system of using all 12 pitches, you know, within an octave to craft what's called a tone row. And that tone row, or even several tone rows, that tone row itself, that tone row upside down, that tone row backwards, that tone row becomes both the harmony and the melody. It's both the harmonic basis and the thematic basis for this new school of composition. The end of the day, I don't know if you agree, but I'm going to just say this because it's my less than humble opinion, doesn't work. It just doesn't work. At the end of the day, I think what finally drove the good compositions that were written in 12-tone technique was that still instinct for the desire for consonants and dissonance, resolution and the absence of resolution. But embedded, and I guess some might say embedded in this 12-tone, the way the tones are chosen, and then the rhythms are chosen in the same way. And it was all about this, you know, it's this exact same rhythm that keeps coming back, and then it's the rhythm backwards, there's the mirror version of the rhythm. It was a very mathematical way.
It looked great on paper.
It did, exactly. and it's not uncommon for those composers to, you know, bring it, you know, during the back in the day, bring their piece. Look, can you see how I worked all this out? It's perfect. You know, it's like, well.
Yes, but what does it sound like?
Exactly.
But it was good that that movement occurred because it sort of opened the door of possibility to composers who came afterwards to indeed have pieces that might have tonality-based sections and then atonal sections and kind of go back and forth. And, you know, I've encountered works that have a 12-tone moment. And in fact, it really works to be able to have those moments, but having an entire piece that way, well, maybe not so much.
You are a freaking mind reader. That is literally exactly what I was going to just say. So now let's come back to Bartok. The year is 1944. All of this 12-tone stuff has already happened. The major works of Berg and Webern and Schoenberg, you know, in the 19-teens, blah, 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 all through World War I and thereafter have happened. So exactly. The harmonic palette is no longer, you know, out of the hymnal. It's much wider than that. It's much, the rules have changed. But with Bartok and this piece, and then what I call the neoclassic and the neo-romantic school of modern composers, Jennifer Higdon being one of them, Rigliano being another, Afner Dorman, there's a lot of wonderful classical composers walking the planet these days. They are, by and large, still using a tonal center so that there is that sense in the piece that we're home now, now we're not home, now we're home again, which is central to what makes orchestral music work. Because at the end of the day, music is the thing, you're sitting in your chair, but it's taking place over time and you're going on a journey. When you go on a journey, you're going to a place and then you're coming back or you're going to a new place or whatever. So music, in order to function, in order to work for an audience, has to have that sense of place. Where's home base? So that when we go on our journey, we can digest that journey in some way. So Bartok does exactly what you just said in Concerto for Orchestra. It's a tonal work. There are melodies that you can sing. There's absolutely a harmonic home base. It is a tonal work, yet the vocabulary of harmony is so colorful and so brilliant, so he's absorbed those atonal sounds, which can sound freaking cool. They can. Like at the opening of Bartok, of the Concerto for Orchestra, he's got this beautiful rising fourth thing in the cellos and basses, and he's in one key in the left hand and a different key in the right hand. And there are these eerie tremolos in the strings in the right hand. And it just sounds great. Let me play it for you. Where's Jen? Uh-oh, okay. Here it is. Let me get them. Listen carefully. Listen. Cool, it's fabulous. You know, the left hand is in C sharp, sort of. The right hand is in C natural, and then these are B flat harmonies in the right hand. So the two hands are in different keys simultaneously. But there's this kind of, you know, foggy, eerie mystery to it.
Almost sounds like what you might encounter on a movie soundtrack.
Absolutely.
And interestingly enough, one of my favorite Bartok works, the music for strings, percussion, and celesta, was used as the soundtrack for The Shining. Bartok didn't write it for that soundtrack, but the person that put the soundtrack together used large chunks of that Bartok music for the soundtrack. And people who think, oh, you know, Bartok is weird and that's not my taste and things like that, when they hear it in the context of a movie, it seems perfectly acceptable and descriptive of the action. And if you listen to this music as if it's creating a picture in your mind, I think it's much more approachable.
No question. And film composers borrow liberally from these classical, 20th century classical composers, precisely for that reason. If you're writing a horror flick, if you're writing an action adventure movie, somehow those same harmonies out of the hymnal, I don't know, it doesn't quite cut it. You know,
sometimes we'll be watching a movie and Greg will go, oh, that soundtrack guy's pretending to be Bartok right now.
Absolutely, absolutely. Let me just play on from here. let me go back to the beginning. Listen to this opening lick in the cellos and basses, and then listen to it the second time. Oops, sorry. C sharp down here, C natural up here. Color, fantastic. It's like new colors got added to the composer's palette. The whole 12-tone year is just everything expanded. Now listen. It's almost the same thing. Just slightly altered a little bit, but the ear definitely hears those cellos and basses coming back, starting on the same C sharp, going up to F sharp. Point is, it ain't random. He's still using those same Beethoven-esque compositional techniques. Take a thing that the audience can grasp and understand, and then change it. But only enough that it starts to be interesting and compelling and entertaining, okay? It really is not the 12-tone technique. These are standard compositional techniques. Development, motivic, thematic development, blah, 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 blah. But now with these incredible new colors from the 12-tone era. Now a third time, but definitely condensed. And moving and expanding. Now on a slightly different level, it sounds the same, but actually D sharp in the left hand. A little innocent flute theme is introduced. It just sounds winding and improvisatory, but it's actually the snippet of the first theme of the piece. And now our zombie is starting to move. Based on that original material, it's now moving zombie-esque. Dramatic, scary. And here's the first theme. All right. I mean, it's not Freude Schönegger, but you can sing it, and it's like, well, what's just happened? We've had this mysterious unveiling of material in a quiet, hushed, mysterious way. We eventually find our way to the first theme. It's exactly like Beethoven 9th Symphony First Movement. Exactly the same structure. So the point is, you know, I would say to this day, the basics of what makes successful music haven't changed in 300 years. The means, the vocabulary, that does change. The instrumentation changes, you know, things of that nature. But though Bartok wrote for his time an extremely modern piece, he used time-honored techniques, and at least in part, that's why the piece works so well. Well, that kind of went a little long. I want to let Rachel tell you guys all about these two gorgeous instruments and whatever else you want to say.
Okay. Well, first of all, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about sort of the development of the violin. Not the whole story, but basically, this family of instruments, the violin, viola, and cello, came into the world around the 1490s or so. Prior to that, you had some of the medieval ancestors of the violin, the viol and the rebec, all those little guys held on the arm. But those instruments really didn't have families. It was the woodwind instruments that could form, you know, quartets of voices, you know, little recorders, bigger recorders, biggest recorders, sort of imitating the soprano, alto, tenor, bass of the ensemble of human voices. But Isabel d'Este, when she became ruler. One of the theories, which I find compelling, is that, usually for the entertainments and the sort of concerts and so forth, you would have these win-win ensembles, but that for the court of a lady, that wasn't exactly appropriate because of the wind instruments' military and phallic associations. And so, therefore, she wanted to still have that same kind of music, but she thought bowed stringed instruments would be more suitable. The little rebecs and raucous things just weren't going to cut it. So she commissioned the best instrument makers in Italy to come up with new ideas. And so they combined aspects of the viol, and that whole story can be an hour lecture in of itself. But in any case, they combined aspects of the medieval bowed stringed instruments, the best elements of a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and came up with two families of instruments, one of which was the violin family, four strings tuned in fifths, held on the arm, and then the other was the viola da gamba family, which is really a bowed lute, a flat back fretted instrument tuned in thirds and fourths, which has little, medium, and big sizes, the viola da gamba, held either on the lap or on the leg. And it was these two families of instruments that were invented at the same time. So if you ever read that the bass viol or the viola da gamba is the ancestor of the cello, that is completely inaccurate. And those two families of instruments took over the world. And eventually in the 1600s, the viola d'amore came along. This instrument is not a separate family, and it doesn't come in different sizes. It's not ever an instrument that you would begin music lessons on or that you would only play this instrument. Kind of in the nature of, you know, a flutist might pick up a piccolo for a particular moment, or an oboe player might pick up an English horn if they wanted a certain sound. But nobody would say, I'm an English horn player and that's all I play. That would just sort of be a silly idea. And so the viola d'amore is no more a viola than a viola da gamba is a viola, meaning the alto member of the violin family. In fact, the string length is a violin size. This instrument is meant to be played by violinists who would pick it up for a certain movement or a certain piece within a larger concert. In the Baroque era, this instrument was written, parts were written for it by Bach, Telemann. Vivaldi wrote 8 concertos for it, and it was really beloved for its color. There were more than 25 different documented tunings and absolutely no standardization of notation, so each piece was its own idea, its own project. And often the music written for this instrument could be played on the violin or the viola, but the composers indicated viola d'amore because they wanted its specific sound. In the classical era, the end of the 1700s, the D tuning was codified, which is a D on the top, one note lower than the E of a violin, then the same A string, and then an F string, which can either be an F sharp or an F natural, depending on if you're in major or minor key, then a D string, which is the same D string, and then an A, and then a D, which is one note higher than the lowest string of a viola, and then if you have a 7-string d'amore, they come in either 6 or 7-string varieties, an A, which is a third lower than the lowest string of a viola. So they have a range which is, encompasses the violin notes, the viola notes, and even a few extras in many cases. And then the underneath strings, these resonating strings that start down here and go under the fingerboard, under the tailpiece, through the bridge, inside the neck, which is hollow, back out the other side and up into these pegs.
Wow.
These notes are tuned to the same as these, so that when you play it, it rings and rings and rings and has a voice that doesn't sound like either a violin or a viola da gamba. Mozart's father, in his famous treatise on violin playing, wrote that the viola d'amore is a special kind of violin that sounds especially lovely in the stillness of the night. So I'll tell you a
hence
little...
the name?
Good point. So the name, why is it called a viola d'amore? Actually, 95% of instruments, this one is an anomaly, 95% of violas d'amore have a blind cupid's head as their scroll. And so that, together with the two sets of strings trembling in unison, many people say, well, it's the viola of love. There's an equally compelling theory, however, that says that the idea of the resonating strings is a very Middle Eastern device, and always the sound holes of a viola d'amore are these Islamic flames. And so people say, well, it must be the viola of the Moors. And the Grove Dictionary of Music and Musicians, which is sort of the Bible of music history in the English language, it very helpfully says of this instrument, its origins are obscure. So if Grove doesn't know, I guess nobody does. We do know that it was invented in more of the Germanic area of Europe as opposed to Italy. But it's sort of mysterious. I'll play you a little bit of a minuet. For 2 hours about the d'amore. That's the Reader's Digest condensed
version.
Can
I ask a couple questions?
Oh, sure.
On that minuet, because there's a fair amount of left-hand pizzicato, is that idiomatic of the nature of the writing for viola d'amore, or is it mostly bowed, or?
Good question. Well, that very short-lived instrument, the arpeggione, had something like 15 strings, and you would pluck some and play some, and it was insane, and there's a reason it didn't catch on. The viola d'amore, by the way, and I'll answer your question in just a sec. The viola d'amore, while it was invented as an instrument of the Baroque period and used by Baroque composers, all the great violin makers made violas d'amore. I actually have a Galliano Baroque violin as well as a Galliano viola d'amore in terms of the Baroque instruments. This is a 19th century instrument. A lot of its great repertoire, wonderful concertos by Stamitz and other pieces like that Melandre suite written in the classical period. And I had said how it was used, how it was beloved for its color in the Baroque era, but once the D tuning was codified, then the composers of the classical era really started to exploit its potential. And that's when you started to see, not that it was particular to this instrument, but just as all the pre-Paganini techniques were starting to enter the violin's repertoire, you also saw those same devices used on the viola d'amore, left-hand pizzicato, harmonics, you know, crazy stuff, and of course all kinds of chording possible with this instrument. If you were playing in the key that the strings were tuned to, you actually had double and triple and quadruple and quintuple and sextuple stops that simply weren't possible on the violin because of the limitations of the mere four strings tuned in fifths. And so it was just taking all those kind of violinistic things and applying them to this instrument. The instrument sort of faded out for the most part, except a little bit in France, during the Romantic period, and then was revived at the beginning of the 20th century with the ancient instrument movement. People mistakenly thought that it was a kind of a viola because it was called a viola d'amore, and in fact it was some of the great violist composers like Cassata, Seuss, and Hindemith who are responsible for its revival. Hindemith wrote a fabulous sonata as well as one of his Kammermusik for soloist and orchestra for this instrument. Cassata, Seuss wrote sort of the Paganini caprices of the d'amore with his 24 preludes, one in each key.
Would you retune the instrument for each
one? No, in fact, that was the innovation of the 20th century composers. They left this detuning. And of course, in earlier times, the whole idea of having this tuning was to then have the piece in that same key with the strings underneath tuned to the same note. So if you were playing a piece in D, it would just ring and ring and ring and ring and ring. Now, of course, if you're playing in B flat minor and you've got it tuned to D major, well, then you're not going to have all that ring. But that was also part of the thinking, is that you would have different keys that then had different flavors, some of them more deadened and some of them more alive. And later on into the 20th and 21st centuries, there have even been experimentation with retuning the resonating strings to more of a chromatic idea. Obviously, you only have seven, and we're not even getting into temperament. But still, they have it more evenly spaced across the scale so that you had a more equal ring depending on what key or what notes you were playing. There have been lots of experiments, but interestingly enough, the detuning of the playing strings has pretty much remained the same since the late 1700s.
Let me take 1 second to interject here. When we're talking about ring, if this is an instrument in D major, I made mention to it earlier, the overtone series and the physics of sound will excite certain pitches and not others. And it's that overtone series, if you study the physics of sound, that makes the difference between my voice and Rachel's, or the timbre, the difference between a clarinet or an oboe. So there'll be, in D major, there'll be certain notes on this instrument that will ring, but in A flat, you know, in the middle octave will not, because it's A flat is not one of the notes in the overtone series. So that ring has everything to do with the physics of sound.
Listen to the difference. It's really obvious on this instrument. Now, this instrument is not on tomorrow night's concert. But if you guys, and hopefully you will, like the Four Seasons enough that you want a little encore, that's why I brought him along, because you know, the orchestra has been nice enough to rehearse the last movement of one of my favorites of the Demore Concertos by Vivaldi. And since Vivaldi was such a fan of this instrument, it's always a great chance to kind of introduce it to people who might not have ever met it before. I'll show you, this is actually the movement we prepared as the last movement of that concerto, but here's how the first movement of that particular Vivaldi concerto starts.
I should have shot some video, but after we rehearsed the Viola d'Amore piece, Rachel kind of said, listen, if any of you string players want to come, you know, give it a try. And it was like a crowd of them. I mean, it's like an instrument petting zoo for grown-up adults, you know. I've actually never seen one of these up close. I've known about Viola d'Amore, obviously, since my graduate school years, but...
4 years ago, I attended the International Viola d'Amore Congress.
Oh, my God.
Which takes place every 2 years. It's a true gathering of geeks. And it was a really large turnout. We had 30 d'Amore players. But that's, if you think about it, that's from the whole world. So these are few and far between.
Fairly rare.
Now, the arpeggioni, there's not even enough of them to have a society. So what's
it? CDs featuring that instrument?
I'm actually halfway through recording a CD which will contain the complete 8 Vivaldi d'Amore concertos. That should be out next year. So what's interesting about Vivaldi's works, of course, his primary job was as the music teacher of a girls' orphanage. And so many of his most beloved compositions were written for teenage girls. And these girls were... this orchestra of girls was renowned throughout Europe. In fact, if you want to read a really evocative sort of historical novel about Vivaldi's girls' school, it has a sort of unnecessarily, title, but it is memorable, and it's alliteration, so probably the editor came up with the title, because the book is not this way. It's called Vivaldi's Virgins. The writer, you know, is obviously inventing a lot of details about the personal lives of the girls and so forth, but it's all very historically based, and it has wonderful, wonderful descriptions of what their daily routine was like, what their music studies were like, what their concerts were like, etc. And interestingly, a lot of these girls were either foundlings or perhaps the illegitimate children of aristocrats who didn't want to acknowledge them, and therefore a lot of them didn't really come with last names. So very often their last name was the name of the instrument in which they specialized. Wow. And there was one particular young lady who was one of the best of the violinists. She was known as Anna Violino. So Anna Violino was also a viola d'amore virtuoso, and it would have been this teenage girl, Anna, who would have played these d'amore concertos on this instrument, which is very impressive. I didn't start playing this till I was in my 20s, and it took me a number of months to get up and running. At first, my left hand would be on string 6, and my bow would be on string 5, and I was completely discombobulated. And if you think of her tearing it up at such a young age on this beast, you know, that's pretty darn impressive. Now,
is this an ancient instrument or a modern replica?
This actually, this particular instrument is a 19th century instrument from the Germany area. So it was made, now, violins, I mentioned that they were invented right at the turn of the century, very end of the 1400s into the beginning of the 1500s when they entered the world. And violins were Baroque instruments for a number of centuries. They had a shorter, fatter neck set on a less steep angle, shorter, lighter kind of wood that the fingerboard was made out of. Their innards were different with very much lighter bass bar and soundpost, the vibrating parts of the instrument in slightly different places, a different kind of bridge, and of course, gut strings, which have always been sheep gut. Cat gut is a myth. Our feline friends have never been sacrificed for music. Their intestines simply aren't long enough.
You say, for the nice people, what that is exactly? What's a gut string? What's it actually made out of?
It's made out of the animal intestines, and still is. Sheep gut mostly, though occasionally gut string makers will use some beef gut for certain lengths for certain instruments, etc. But most gut strings are sheep gut, a lot of it from New Zealand, of course, these days. And the modernization of instruments occurred in the late 1700s. Lots of explanations for it, concerts moving from the private drawing rooms of the aristocracy, maybe spaces about this size, into public concert halls for the emerging middle class, where the bigger the room, the more tickets you could sell for the entrepreneurial musicians who wanted to put on these shows and be independent. All of the modernizations were really done to make the instruments louder, the steeper angle of the neck, the different kind of bow made out of pernambuco wood from Brazil, which is a completely different aerodynamic shape, and I'll demonstrate these in just a sec. The modernization of the violin family instruments and the new kind of bow entered at the same time, and it was a totally new sound. Now, in technology, we always think of innovation as progress and as improvement. In art, it's really not that way. It's simply different sounds for different eras or different aesthetics. When you think about visual art, the great works of the 1500s in terms of painters are not superior to the great works of the 1700s, which are not superior to the great works or inferior to the great works of the 1900s. You can't say the great impressionists are better than Michelangelo, or vice versa. It's just different means of expression. And some people that say, well, why would you play a Baroque instrument when you can play a new, improved, modern instrument? Well, why would you, ride a horse when you can drive a car? That's one line that people like to use. Well, okay, the car protects you from the rain and it can go faster, but what happens if you need to jump over a hedge? So there are certain things the horse can do that the car can't. And so what happened is that an instrument like this, which is a Guarneri violin made in 1742, same year and maker as Paganini's instrument, they would cut off the neck and insert the modern neck. They would lift off the top and rearrange the innards. It was a honest-to-goodness sex change operation. Not minor surgery. And
ouch!
And then, of course, instruments being made subsequent to that were made from the get-go in the modern way. Interestingly, the viola da gamba family, those instruments with the 6 strings and the frets bowed on the leg or on the lap that I mentioned earlier, those remained sort of an ancient, early music instrument. They didn't really, their repertoire and their design didn't extend forward into modern times. But the violin family, of course, became a modern instrument, and the viola Demore did as well. So a lot of the great 18th century demores have been long since modernized, and they're also, like this one, is our instruments made in the modern style as modern instruments. And we think, when we think of violas demore, we think, oh, Bach and Vivaldi. But in fact, more than half of this instrument's repertoire has now been written in the 20th and 21st centuries. And just as there are players of the violin family instruments who have never tried their hand at period instruments, there are players of the viola demore who only play modern demore. And indeed, the Anchorage Symphony, of course, they all play modern instruments, and yet we're doing a Baroque piece. So one of the goals in those situations is to sort of combine the best of both worlds, to use our brilliant modern equipment, which is much more suitable for a large hall like the symphony's home, but to bring a little bit of a Baroque aesthetic to that band. And so I'm actually performing with a Baroque bow, which is the kind of stick that would have been used in Vivaldi's time. It's made out of a type of wood called snake wood. If you look very closely, the grain of the wood resembles a mottled snake skin. And I'll show you the difference in the way these bows function. This is the opening of a Bach bourrée, and you'll see that the chords are very fluid, very round. And it has certain gestures that feel ergonomically very comfortable. Now this bow, doing what it wants to do naturally, has a much sharper attack, and you could never play Brahms with this thing. So here's what this one would do with Bach. That is how many people approach Baroque music, with more of a 19th century type of a sound, and that can be done perfectly gorgeously and is a legitimate interpretative approach. But if you want to use more of an 18th century approach with this bow, you have to kind of fake it. Now for me, because I'm so used to this bow, trying to do that with this bow, I'm going against its nature, and I feel like I'm working twice as hard for not quite as much result. And it's easier to just pick this guy up and let it do the work. But of course, that's because I've spent many years practicing on this bow, and I've gotten used to it. For people that have never played this bow, it might be a bit awkward to pick it up for the first time. So therefore, you'll notice that the members of the symphony are using their modern bows, but as the maestro mentioned in rehearsal, I've been demonstrating for them what we're trying to achieve with this bow, and they're doing a wonderful job of trying to find some of those same sounds with this later equipment.
Speaking of trying to find those same sounds, tell us a little bit about vibrato and, you know, why it's normally not used in Baroque string playing, and when tell us about the transition into the vibrato sounds of the 19th century, the 20th century.
Yeah, so, you know, what we think of as a gorgeous, you know, rich, sustained sound, you know, of shift. Those are, well, those expressive slides are sort of, you know, not written on the page. You just see the notes and you add them to add color and add interest. In fact, I often think of those as a type of an improvisation or a personalization of the music. Even if we're not adding notes to what the composer wrote, we're adding our own fingerings, what width, what speed of vibrato. But the vibrato is more continuous in the Baroque period because of these special bows, which, like I said, they're not strong enough to play the later repertoire, and so they were abandoned when it came to later periods of music. But in the time of Bach, the time of Corelli and Handel, these bows have so much color and so many subtleties that, in fact, a lot of what we now do with our gradations of vibrato and all of that variety was done instead with the sound of the bow. You know, stuff that we would just not think of with these modern bows, which tend to want to have a more uniform sound, and then the variety comes from the left hand. And vibrato was used every once in a while as a special decoration, kind of like putting on a piece of jewelry to finish your outfit. Now, as with jewelry, if you have too much of it, you can just end up looking gaudy and silly. But if you have none of it, then your outfit isn't quite completed. You need your accessories. And so it was for the Baroque melodies. So a lot of the slow movements, as well as certain moments within the outer movements, I actually am improvising what we call ornaments. So what Vivaldi wrote on the page, lovely melody, but it's a bit bare, just like a jazz player would never play just the bare melody. They would have to add some melismas or things. So I might one day and the next day I might just whatever I feel like that day, I can just add some decorations and make it very spontaneous, and not adding ornaments for their own sake, but when the line moves in a certain direction, the ornaments follow the phrase, or when a certain moment becomes more intense, I might ornament a bit more floridly, and when a moment is more calm and simple, I might ornament a bit more sparingly.
And that was a huge component of being a soloist back in the day, and all the way up until, I don't know, what would you say, the dawn of the 20th century? To some extent overlapping, where the soloist had license in the Baroque era to essentially add notes and ornaments and things like that.
Now, of course, there is still improvisation in today's concertos, or, I shouldn't say today's, and in Romantic concertos, which we still think of as today's concertos. For example, the beginning of the Brook G minor. On the page, here's what he wrote. Hear it played that way. There would be so much interesting use of vibrato, of timing, that you would push and pull the beat with your own extemporaneous ideas. Month when I play with a different orchestra, maybe I'm more in the mood to do this.
We've only got a minute or two left. Any questions for Rachel?
Yes, when were that strings replaced by steel?
It was actually more of a gradual process than some of the other innovations. Once the violin started being re-necked, they took most of them and chopped them apart and modernized them. Once the new bow came into existence, they just threw most of these away. It was a pretty quick overtaking of the old way, but gut strings faded out much more gradually. Even in Heifetz's time, he was still using a gut E string. There were wrapped, sort of gut wound with silver for some of the lower strings. The synthetics really came into their heyday in the 20th century, but there were various people using various combinations of things in the 19th. Now, some people will use the wrapped gut. There's one cellist, I think it's Stephen Isserles, who loves the sound of the wound gut, so a gut core with the metal wrapped around to the surface of the instrument. He loves the colors that it gets. Sadly, it doesn't have the projection So, you know, those gorgeous colors are great if you can hear them. but if you're in the back of the hall and the hall is pretty big, well, then you're going, gosh darn it, why didn't he use some nice synthetic strings? So it's a compromise. Other questions?
How difficult is it to tune the viola?
Don't worry.
Ah, yes. Well, you have, in this case, 14 as opposed to 4. Of course, harp players would have no sympathy for me. I wouldn't say it's difficult. It's just painstaking. It just takes a while. I have to literally plan, you know, okay, I've got to build in to my pre-concert routine, okay, from 6:15 to 6:35, I'm going to put on my makeup and do my hair, and then I'm going to warm up, and then I'm going to tune my demore. That adds another component to what you have to be sure to squeeze in to the number of minutes at hand that are available to you. And of course, because it is tuned to a chord rather than in fifths, you have to make sure that the A's and the D's all match each other, and then where you put the third, and you know, it's, yeah, and then to make sure that all these guys match these guys, and yeah, it's to do it well. If it's already like pretty close, it can still take 20 minutes of chasing it around, and then you have to hope that if it's in tune to itself that you haven't accidentally veered from exactly the A that the orchestra is going to want you to match. So thank goodness for iPhone apps. Yes.
Last question.
The demores, are they primarily from Germany, or were they made primarily in Germany, or primarily in Italy? Are most of these instruments from one or the other?
Yeah, good question. So once the demores were introduced in the Germany area in the 1600s, then all the great, you know, you just go down the line, not Del Gesu, because he made so few instruments anyway, but, and we don't know whether Strad actually made a demore. If he did, it's been lost, but he did leave a complete pattern for a demore. Oh. But every other great maker you can possibly name, you know, Galliano, Testore, I mean, just, you go down the line, you know, Grancino, this, everybody made demores. It was an important instrument. Even people that didn't make violas da gamba made viola d'amores, because they were seen as a, you know, a cousin of the violin and part of that sort of a, yeah, related to the family.
It's a rarity now, but it wasn't a rarity then.
Correct. But there are makers in Germany who specialize in d'amore, whose d'amores are very, very highly considered, whereas if that same guy had made a violin or did make a violin, they wouldn't be particularly of notice. So that is one difference. On the other hand, you know, an instrument's worth is not sort of inherent. It also is market-driven, of course, based on its rarity, its quality, its provenance, and its desirability. And so, interestingly, the two Galianos that I have, the violin from 1770, the viola d'amore from 1774, those are my two Baroque instruments. They're both in completely original, unmodernized condition. They're both in equal good health. They're both of equal quality. The Baroque violin cost $250,000, and the d'amore cost only $50,000. because there's simply less of a market for it. Yes.
I don't know anything about violins. Is this particular instrument you're going to play Saturday night completely different than what the orchestra has?
This violin is a typical soloist instrument. The two greatest makers in the world are considered to be Stradivari and Guarneri. And one of the reasons they are the most desirable is not just because of the you know, other instruments have beautiful tone colors, but simply not as many of them. It's like painting with thousands of colors as opposed to millions. But also, those great instruments are desirable as solo instruments because they project unamplified into the last row with no problem over a whole orchestra. Not many instruments can do that. So a lot of instruments that would be perfectly great, hearing their voice alone in the context of, say, a string quartet, cannot get up and play a concerto. It's what makes these instruments so valuable, as well as, of course, collectors pushing up the price. But
that is a standard violin. It's the same instrument that the violin is.
So it would have begun life as a Baroque violin, but it would have been very early on into the 1800s when it would have been modernized, and it's been modernized ever since. This is a regular kind of a violin. The only difference between what I'm doing, and probably in the orchestra there are others who might have 18th century instruments that had been modernized long ago, and then some people who are playing 19th century or 20th or 21st century instruments, but all in the modern style. The only difference with what I'll be doing is that I'll be using a Baroque bow, and it's, as I said, it's just laziness, because I would have to work so much more harder if I tried to play Vivaldi on this thing.
We need to stop. Rachel is actually going to be here for a few minutes longer if you guys want to come up and ask questions. Would you join me in thanking her?